Hello everybody, it's me, GhostCritic, and I'm here with my Sunday comic book review video. And probably by the time this goes live, the Oscars will probably be in full flow. A whole gamut of celebrities and movie stars will be receiving awards for films that they've been in over the last year. So I thought we'd have a little bit of fun again this week and I'd make up my own Oscar category awards for the books that I picked up this Wednesday. So I hope you enjoy what is to come. Just a warning, a spoiler warning, because apparently I need to do this now. I will be talking about the comic books I pulled on Wednesday, just gone. So I'll be talking about storylines, I'll be talking plot lines, I'll be revealing stuff that's happened in the books. So if you've not read any of these titles yet, as soon as you see me lift one up and you haven't read it, pause the video, go read it, or forward the video on until you can't see me holding up that copy anymore, because I'll have stopped talking about it. So let's get on with our first Oscar award category, and that is a tie-in comic that has virtually nothing to do with the event it purports to be involved with award. And that goes to Extraordinary X-Men, issue number 19, part of the Inhumans versus X-Men event that is currently going on. I feel for Jeff Lemire so much because the story inside of this is clearly what he wanted to do, but he's had to kind of mould it and fold it and get it involved with this ridiculous event that's going on at the moment, trying to make the Inhumans relevant in the Marvel Universe as movies, TV shows, whatever the Inhumans will be in celluloid form. And so we have this, which, to be fair, isn't that bad of a story. It kind of almost wraps up the whole Sapner going bad, having to make the sacrifice and dying and being part of Magic Soul Sword. And while I don't think this has ever happened before, it probably has. I'm not like 100% a fay with how the Soul Sword works, but Sapner has managed to pull magic into the sword because she's lonely. Bless her little heart. She just wants a friend, and magic is that friend for her before she died, and she wants to continue that relationship even if it means magic is trapped in the sword as well. And of course, everything going on outside the battle between the Inhumans and the X-Men, which you see very, very little of, and seems to have no consequences whatsoever to the story that we're involved with, which is just a shame. But this is what happens, especially with the X titles. I've collected so many of these pretty good to really good titles within the X franchise that get tarnished with the event books, get pulled in, and eventually get ruined because the writer, the artist, has no option but to go with the editorial mandate that says this comic must tie in, even if it's only a slither of a tie-in to our main event that's happening now. I've been looking at solicitations, and it looks as though, because you never know with these books taking hiatus or bad monthly regulars going on, but it does look like this book will come to an end to make way for the slew of new X-Men books that are coming very, very soon. And it's par for the course for these X titles now. They very rarely go on for very much longer before getting either cancelled, renumbered back to issue number one. Not a huge loss. It hasn't been an epic run, despite the fact that we've got a great writer on here of Jeff Lemire, but he's not really been able to like stretch his kind of writing chops on this book. Each time it seems to be building somewhere really good, it gets dragged back with a tie-in, and that is a shame. Moving on to the award for We're Getting Cancelled Comic, so we better start wrapping things up quick. And that goes to Gail Simone's Clean Room, issue number 16. Yes, if you believe what is on the internet and what's on all these comic book websites, as contradictory as some of them are, either this book is just going on a really long hiatus and this is kind of like season one and it's coming back for season two many down the line, or this book has just been outright cancelled. So you do get the feeling from especially this issue that Gail Simone is having to kind of maybe speed up this storyline somewhat to at least give the readers a sense of an ending just in case it doesn't come back. And in this issue, we have, I guess, the infiltration of Astrid's kind of cult group by these demons. And this has been going on for years and years. And it has come to this culmination of the reveal of people within this Mueller Institute taking down all the main characters, or at least trying to. And it doesn't hold back on the guts, the gory, the violent, the surreal. It has been a fantastic book from the very beginning. I've been so invested in this Vertigo title, and it's such a shame that this could be coming to a final end very, very soon. It has been kind of like real kind of psychological horror right at the very beginning of this book. As we moved on with it, we weren't sure whose side we should be rooting for, who were the good guys, who were the bad guys. You certainly can see who the bad guys are now. And we've been taken on this trip by Gail Simone with so many twists and turns. I really do hope that if, you know, this book is cancelled, Gail Simone does the rest of the issues justice and wraps not necessarily everything up in a nice, neat little bow, because that's not always the case for any story, regardless of the medium you read it in. But I don't just want her to have rushed the end because she wants to throw everything in before we say goodbye. Great art by, who was the artist on here? Giovanni and Winter. As always, I say this, but it's true. It really does have that kind of old school Vertigo feel from back in like the late 80s, early 90s. And coupled with that kind of horror element that, you know, you wouldn't really see in a mainstream DC comic, this has been an almost perfect read for me month after month. I can't say start picking this up really, because it's going to come to an end, but really do look out for the trades, give it some support that way, and then maybe Vertigo or the heads of DC will go, oh, people seem to like that now, we'll give it another shot. So Clean Room, Gail Simone. Our next award, the noble sacrifice of a villainous character who just redeemed themselves and will no doubt go back to said villainous ways, award goes to Wonder Woman, issue number 17. And we are firmly in with Barbara Minerva here, as she tries to help out her friends from this kind of corporation who want to find Themyscira, and they are following Steve Rogers. Is it Steve Rogers? I always get that wrong. You know who I mean. Steve. Whatever his name is. They're on the run. They've found the kind of Minotaur guy who seems to be kind of down on his luck. I don't quite know what that's about. Probably people with more knowledge of the Wonder Woman series might be able to help me out there. But they've gone to him for help. But our evil corporation is hot on their heels and it all guns are blazing. And it's up to Barbara Minerva to make that noble sacrifice of seemingly turning against her friends but being kind of backed into a corner. And our evil corporation turns poor Barbara Minerva back into Cheetah, one of Wonder Woman's main kind of rogues gallery of villains. And it does kind of feel really kind of emotional for Barbara and as the reader that she's tried so hard to be that good person, to make friends despite her kind of evil and wicked past. She's finally kind of got new friends and made herself a new life and put herself alongside Wonder Woman to kind of help the world, make it a better place, so forth. But now, unfortunately, she has to go back, and it's done so well. I love the artist on here, Liam Sharp. He does great stuff on here with colorist. I wonder, Martin, which Martin is it? Because there are so many Martins going on in here in the comic book. It is Laura Martin. So I don't know who she is, but she does a really good job here. I'm really enjoying Wonder Woman. I like the two storylines that are running kind of week, 1 week off, 1 week on. So that's great stuff, getting a lot of broad ideas of what Wonder Woman is about, and Greg Rucka really doing a great job in bringing in new readers, keeping probably long-term readers to the Wonder Woman franchise happy as well. And so, great stuff. We are gone to our next Oscar comic book award, and that goes to Descender, issue number 19, the Holding Pattern Award. Yes, we had the big switcheroo of our Tims in the cliffhanger of last issue, and this is very much an issue setting up for the next big thing, as the war between the machines and all the planets with all the rest of the kind of humans on seems to be growing and growing. And it wasn't that this was bad, there was just a lot of explanation, a lot of talking going on, trying to move that next storyline to the next step. And we just probably needed a little bit more momentum forward. But still, I've always loved Descender. The artwork by Dustin Jurgen is just lovely to look at. Very sparse in pages, very kind of very white and clean and almost sterile in this kind of sci-fi story, which is really nice. But it's got this kind of rough painted art style to it as well that I find very unique with this book. We get kind of Driller's confession from the storyline that we had a few issues ago, where we learned that when he was working for the mining company and the machines were all coming in and all the humans were trying to get out, he was mad at the way he was being treated, and so he allowed a number of humans to be gassed. He was getting his revenge for the way he had been treated, and he's feeling very guilty about it now and just decides to throw himself off out into space, and to the reveal of the older brother, I forget his name, but he realizes that Driller killed his mother and clearly not very happy about it and has no remorse, I guess, for the death of Driller as he floats off into space, if death is really a thing for a robot. But it's heading somewhere, and I'm willing, because I really do like this book, I'm willing to hold on to it and keep this holding pattern going, but enjoy this very, very much. Our next crazy Oscar Award nomination is the How Does a Comic Get to 21 Issues with essentially the one storyline and still be incredibly entertaining and not boring award goes to David Lapham's Stray Bullets issue 21. And it's true, this new series of Stray Bullets, Sunshine and Roses, has essentially been this crazy, screwed up crime caper that has just blown out of all proportion. Whatever could go wrong did go wrong and will still go wrong. And David Lapham is so crazily good at keeping this, one, entertaining, two, if this is the right word really, intelligible. You know, there's no out of place thing here. Everything leads to a point. And we've said in issues previous that it looked as though a story was more of a digression somewhere else and had nothing to do with the story, but Lapham, crazy great genius of a storyteller, manages to weave all these digressions into our main story and just grow this Stray Bullets universe and world that he's created just bigger and bigger. And as preposterous as some of the storylines can go to, they are still hugely fun to read. And as we said in previous seasons, volumes, these have been very short, maybe 6 to 8 storyline issue kind of mini series, but this can go on as long as it wants. This can go to any crazy lengths. I'm happy with it. The quality has not dipped at all. Every time I pick up Stray Bullets, I know I'm going to be in for not only laughs, there's going to be some poignancy, some emotional bits. It can get really farcical at times, but there's still that element of danger and tension. He does it all. It's amazing how well this does. And I don't hear a lot of people talking about it. I don't know whether it's just, is it because it's in black and white? Is it because the artwork isn't as, I don't know, finessed as many other of the Image titles, but the guy's doing it all himself and he's managing to bring this out issue after issue on time, as far as I know, for quite some time. So props to David Lapham for this, and shame on you for not picking this up. Moving on to our next category, which is the Why Don't We Just Kill Him Already award, and that goes to The Flash, issue number 17, as The Flash prepares himself to take battle with Captain Cold. The other Rogues Gallery come in to join the fight, and it's that moment that we see so many times in comic books where the hero seems to have been captured. Has nowhere else to go, is in the most impossible situation, and would be unable to escape. You just go, just as Glider does in this issue, just kill him now and get it over with. You've won then. And I know it's comic books, I understand that, but it is a weird kind of plot device that goes through so many comic books. It's not just The Flash. It must have happened, and probably has happened, to every major comic book character, regardless of publishing house. They've got him on the ropes here. It looks like The Flash is done for, but the other Rogues kind of manage to persuade Glider out of it, and giving Flash the opportunity to escape, and then finally, you know, beat the Rogues. And as much, and it is a huge lot of fun. For The Flash, you know, you've got to have it fast, you've got to have it quick, it's got to be kinetic, it's got to be colourful, it's got to be exciting, and Joshua Williamson does this in spades, and along with the artists and colourists, regardless of the interchange between each issue, they do a fantastic job in keeping my attention and keeping me entertained. We have a kind of little moral type story conclusion at the end where Captain Cold kind of accuses the Flash of actually enjoying what he does in taking down these villains time after time after time. But, and I think he's just trying to get into his head, so to speak. But the Flash goes, yes, I want to have, you know, the population of, you know, Central City happy and enjoy their lives without danger. I don't want them to lose out on the happiness that they deserve. And if it takes me to do that, then I'm gonna do it. However, kind of, and he says that he's like, he's still lost in all this, and that's the kind of the sacrifice your hero takes, you know, to make everyone else around them happy. He's got to take it on the chin, so to speak. But I love The Flash. It's a great book. I don't know why I've never picked up this earlier and on other volumes, but good stuff. On to our next Oscar award, and the Part Will Be Bigger Than Its Whole award goes to Commandy. Issue number 2, you heard me last month rapture joyously about this book, and I will equally enjoy reading this as I will the next 10 issues. But as I mentioned to Damien, Sleepy Reader, on the comment section of my Wednesday comic book pull list video, I'm not oblivious to the fact that this is gonna feel very episodic, in the sense that there isn't gonna be this one real, because there is a kind of overarching storyline that's gonna go through this, but it's gonna feel very episodic in this fact that, yes, we've got this writer and artist telling their story here, and while the next one has to kind of finish off what they've done and get the cliffhanger to the next place, they're then going to start telling their own story, and it's going to feel kind of a mismatch at times. And that's why I believe that this will still be a great series to read. It will still be entertaining as hell, and you're just not going to know what's coming next with each issue as it goes on, and that's a lot of the excitement and the fun in this book. But as a whole, if when this gets collected, I think it's not going to feel as smooth flowing as just say one writer and artist doing the whole 12 issues. But love this. It was Peter Tomasi and Neil Adams taking over the story from last issue, where Commandy was in the clutches of the Tigers, not the Lions as I said last time, the Tigers, as they have set what seems to be a nuclear war missile on countdown. How is this going to happen? How is this going to be concluded? And in fact, it's a bit of a dupe. This is a Trojan horse, as the counter counts down to zero. And just as it hits zero, what comes out of the warhead? But the gorilla army. And we have huge, great gorillas. And so we have this great big scene of gorillas attacking the Tiger Clan, while Commandy then runs off to that museum we saw in the first issue, which houses all these kind of war memorabilia, and he's hoping to find something he can use in there. And the one of the fun things about this, and I'm sure this will be used ongoing as the issues come out, but they're really throwing in a great deal of DC old history. Whether it be kind of very self-referential, there is a moment where Well, let's just back up a little bit. In this kind of museum of kind of war relics that he's looking for, Commandy crashes through the floor to kind of like an underground basement, and there is Metron's chair. Metron, part of Commandy's New Gods Fourth World series, which can slip through time and space, and he sits on it and it flies off, taking with him Canis and Tufton. And as they're zooming through, we get this great big page of kind of, well, we don't know, they're kind of just random images. We see our kind of comic book Holy Trinity, Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman in the corner. We see these kind of rows of comics, and they're all kind of connected in with Jack Kirby. We see a copy of the New 52 OMAC. There's a Commandy in there. We can just see the corner of a New Gods comic. So it is very self-referential, but I do love these little kind of Easter egg tidbits in there as the chair flies them to another part of this crazy screwed up world, and we turn up into San Diego with Tufton and Canis, and this is apparently where all the wild humans reside. But before we get a chance to see them, another bit of DC history gets thrown in, and we see the Manhunters, those kind of sentient robots, I think they were, who want to wipe out humanity. They come crashing in, and the only escape for Commandy is throwing himself off this ledge, and that's where the cliffhanger ends. How will our next team of Palamotti and Connor wrap up that to tell their story? But just again, fun all the way, just what I'm looking for. I love this new series of the Commandy Challenge. Our penultimate award this week goes to an Image comic, and that is the Just Soak It All In Award, and that goes to Monstrous. Monstrous issue number 10, Marjorie Liu and Sana Takeda. Oh, this was such a beautiful book to look at and to read. It reminded me of, I know I'm on this Conan kick at the moment and have been for a long time, but obviously if you've seen my last haul video that I put up on Friday, you'll have seen much more of that. But it just felt very much like a Conan story, where we have our main character with all these kind of multitude of talking cats and anthropomorphic foxes, headed to the Isle of Bones, going back to where her mother had once ventured, trying to find out all her secrets and find out what happened to her mother. And between the two creators on this book, they deliver this most nightmarish but still dreamlike world, where we have these monsters that lurk under the water as they're sailing closer and closer to the isle. We have ghosts and kind of spectral beings flying all around. We have this kind of skeletal toll man who's gonna ship them closer to the Isle of Bones and get them to their destination. We have these inhabitants of the island all covered in masks. And then finally, the person that they've been trying to get to, this wonderful regal looking fox, this anthropomorphic fox type character. And it's just done so well. The beauty and the story coupled with the gorgeous artwork, I never thought this would do as well as it did. I felt that, you know, early on and with its kind of hiatus between storylines, I thought people are going to lose interest in this, or this isn't going to go on as long as we would like it to. But I really do urge you, pick up this gorgeous book. It's a great story. It's very high fantasy, so if you really like that genre, this certainly is the book for you, but I just know when I'm going to open the pages of this title, I'm going to be treated to some great storytelling, some great art, and it's going to want me to read the next one. It's going to be just leaving me in anticipation. Can't wait for the next issue. So, our final issue on our final award of this week. And that goes the Lifetime Achievement Award. And it goes to Astro City, issue number 41. But it is actually the 100th issue overall of Astro City. This was fantastic. And why wouldn't it be from the great storyteller Kurt Busiek? It's an extra long issue for its 100th special. And I didn't feel bored, or I didn't feel a page was wasted, as although we've got to the 100th issue, Kurt Busiek takes us right back to the very beginning. Not just the beginning of his run on here, but the beginning of the history of Astro City. How did Astro City come about? Who was the first hero that kind of came into this city? Because right at the very beginning, we have this town. It's not called Astro City yet, but we have a man with a vision, a man with a dream of bettering society. And his dreams take him so far, space, other dimensions, other planets. And with those adventures and journeys that we see still only little snippets of, but feel like we've lived through them with this character, he brings back that technology, that knowledge, that education from those adventures and those planets he's visited, to make the world, or at least that city he lives in, that much easier and better. But of course, with that kind of popularity, with that kind of glare of the kind of world looking at you, that's going to get the attention of, you know, governments and armies, who are going to want to use that technology, that power for themselves. And he sees how that kind of knowledge has wrought chaos, wars on other planets, and he doesn't want that to happen for Earth, and in particular this city and town he lives in. And as this is going on, Busiek weaves in the way that more superheroes join our astronaut here, and how the superhero community grows and grows and becomes bigger. And by the end of this issue, as downbeat as it feels for our main character, it beckons the dawn of Astro City, this fantastic civilization, this habitat where the most amazing things happen, where people flock to, tourists, visitors, people who want to live there. And this is what we've seen in every single volume of Astro City until where we are now. And it's just so well told. It's just from the very first page to the last page. It's a done-in-one story that just, he could have easily just stretched out for like a 4, 5, 6 issue story arc. But he is so clever in being a concise storyteller that he can do this all in one, and you don't feel you've missed out on anything. It's great that he got back Brent Anderson for the artwork. Those two coupled together just make a great team. I know that Busiek has kind of given Anderson a little bit of a break over the last maybe at least six or seven issues, and used other people, probably because Anderson was working on this. But great jumping on point. I have to say, if you've not read Astro City before, I mean, you can't have a better start than this. Who knows how much longer this run of Astro City will go. Long, long may it reign, because this is the longest run of an Astro City volume to date. So, and it's Kirby Uzak. He tells the greatest stories, whether they're done in one or kind of a long story arc. You just feel invested in these characters. He really takes you on a journey with them, and you feel for them. You become involved in their lives, just like the inhabitants of Astro City who look up in the skies and see these just amazing characters that are superhuman and beyond what your brain could really, you know, cope with. But they're there protecting you, saving you time after time. Just a great book. My favourite of the week. So, thank you very much for watching my comic book Oscar celebration ceremony. I hope you enjoyed that. Another bit of fun for me this week to make this more entertaining. Not just for me, but for you guys as well. So, until next week when I'll have another comic book review video, don't forget to subscribe, give this video a big thumbs up, and in the comments section below, let me know what you thought of the comic books I picked up this week, and I will see you soon. Bye-bye.